So I'm Andrew West. I'm an assistant professor here at Boston University in the Department of Astronomy. So the course that I've think had the most success, at least in motivating students, and certainly that I've had the most experience at here at Boston University, is a course that I designed called Alien Worlds, which is a class that is an introductory level class, so for non-majors, that introduces students to a lot of the concepts and procedures that we use for both identifying and characterizing planets around other stars. And I've taught the course four times now, and it's ranged from about 40 students to the last two times I've taught it, it's been maxed out at 230 students. So large range, and then a couple in the middle. I have very few specific content goals. I have a few techniques I really want them to learn. I want them to learn a little bit about the physics of gravity and planetary motion. And other than that, my main goal for the course is to really teach students that science changes. So many of the students who come in, haven't taken a science class since they were in high school, even if they were seniors right now at BU. And so, their last science class may have been, AP Bio, where they basically memorized a bunch of terms, spit them back out on a test, and their view of science is this textbook where they read the textbook, it's absolute truth, they memorize it, they spit it back out, and they get an A, and yay, they're great scientists. Certainly my primary goal is to completely destroy that image of science in their brain and demonstrate to them that science is a living, breathing process that's also being performed now, not by a bunch of dead white dudes, but by living, breathing scientists who come in a variety of shapes and colors and ages and whatnot. That really ends up being my primary goal. In fact, I do, anyone who's visited my class knows I do this call and response starting on day one, where I think almost every day in class I ask an entire class full of 200 people, what does science do, or why did that happen? And the whole class responds, hopefully yelling, science changes. So that by the end, they really hopefully have seen that in action. And the topic of planets around other stars, or what we call exoplanets, really lends itself to that, because it is a topic in science that is changing on a day-to-day basis. Almost every day in the news, there are new things happening. And so literally, some of the things I tell them on day one of class aren't true by the last day of class. And there's very few topics in a university where we can actually demonstrate that to non-majors in as effective way. So they literally see by the end of the class that science has changed. A wonderful example is every year we've gone to the Museum of Science here in Boston, to the planetarium show, and the last few years there's been this show on exoplanets. It's now horribly out of date. It was designed in 2010 or 11, but there's this really fun statement in there where a preeminent exoplanet scientist who's maybe from a university in the Boston area that will go unnamed is talking about exoplanets and how we're going to be discovering more of them, and talks about the different types of stars that they might be around, and basically says, a lot of the stars in our galaxy are binary stars, and basically, you can't have planets around binary stars. Pretty blanket statement. And literally, I think 2 months after that planetarium show went live, they found planets around a binary star. And so, we watched the press release in Alien Worlds. So it's actually, NASA does all their press releases at 2 p.m. Eastern on Tuesdays or Thursdays. And that's exactly when my class is. And so we actually watch the press releases sometimes in class. And it's fun because I don't actually know what they're going to be. I'll see that it's going to be something about exoplanets, and I'll tell the class, I have no idea what they're going to say. And that was actually one, and we had already been to the planetarium. And so I was like, oh, guess what? Professor so-and-so was wrong. And science does what? And you know what they said? Changes. So, yeah. So again, I think some of those goal things are not as hard to change, just given the examples we have. Certainly the math phobia and the math stuff. I still struggle a lot with how to get students to even want to do basic ratio and proportions, or understand the inverse square law of gravity in a way that doesn't make them run for the hills when they see a square in the denominator of an equation and how to apply that. I mean, I give lots of examples, and we do a lot of things in class, even in the big class, where we do like think, pair, share, where I have them even in a giant concert hall break into small groups and talk amongst each other and work on problems. And we don't do clickers, but I do kind of a style of clicker-ish stuff. We do lots of multiple choice kind of questions where they have to vote and work in teams and re-vote and kind of similar style to what people doing clickers are doing. And that certainly helps, but I think that's still a piece that I'm working on in my own teaching strategy. In terms of students bringing questions, I mean, there are a number of fora that students can do that. And some of them I've already talked about, things like the social media. So Facebook, a lot of questions come up about, you know, something that either is right on topic or maybe slightly off. You know, they see an article and they want to know a little bit more. And that forum becomes a place where we discuss those. And then once in a while, if it's really relevant to whatever we're talking about in class, I will say, you know, so-and-so talked about this in the Facebook group. Let's actually bring it up in class. You know, also these minute papers do exactly the same thing. So students will come up with very, sometimes big questions in there. And one of the techniques I do and encourage my teaching fellows to do is not only answer the question, but if they have something that's, you know, really important for the class, I actually write in my response, and I instruct my TFs to do the same. I instruct them to tell the student to actually ask the question in class. So, you know, I say like, wow, wonderful question, Rachel. Can you please ask that at the very beginning of class? Because I leave the first like 5 minutes of class open for questions. And so I'll encourage someone in a minute paper to make sure they ask that in front of the whole class. And sometimes they're still shy. I'll say, oh, Rachel, I thought you said you had a question earlier. And she'll say, yes. So in that way, I'm bringing things in like that. And the thing I've been starting to do, which is really fun, and I've certainly shared this with all of my younger colleagues, is to, you know, bring other voices in, especially to an introductory science class. You know, demonstrate that science is an ongoing process, and that it's not all even living white dudes, that there is a diversity of people working on science. And so I've actually started having just brief Skype-in sessions with some of my friends and colleagues around the country. So if one of my friends is one of those ones that had a press release that, you know, either showed up on Facebook or I saw in the news, I usually give them a call and say, hey, could you Skype in for 5 minutes of my class? And they love it. And my students love it. You know, I get to talk with Dr. Andrew Howard at University of Hawaii. And he did this last semester. He turned his laptop around. He's obviously like, look, I'm in Hawaii. And, you know, I mean, it was really fun. And again, huge response from the students for that. And partly because they get to see that this is a living, breathing process that we all are participating in.